Yeah, so I have the pleasure of being able to speak to you as the first today, and it's a great pleasure, of course. And according to the program, it seems like I have around 2 hours for this small presentation. So that was a joke. I don't have 2 hours. No, I will probably try to keep it a little bit short, but nevertheless, I would like to give you a few, let's say, perspectives on the theoretical framework. And we started working, preparing also a draft paper, which will be available, but it is very much a draft, and it's something which I suppose that we will develop much further here in the coming months, not least based on the feedback from all the good experts sitting here in this room. So this is a very first contribution by Dimitri Val. Where are you, Dimitri? Yeah, it's sitting there. So this is Dimitri Val and Sebastian Tünsch, you already have seen, and I am Michael Faber. And now I'm trying to see if this would actually work. Yeah, it seems so. Something is working. Okay, so I would like to go through these few points in the next couple of minutes, looking at the underlying motivation, a few words on structural health monitoring, engineering decision-making, decision and VOI analysis, and then I will just introduce in a very, very simple manner the basic concepts of VOI analysis according to the Bayesian pre-posterior decision analysis in the extensive form as an example, whereby we can adjust a little bit our mindsets. Then I'm going to point at some interesting recent works in the field, and I will conclude by suggesting a little bit summing up of the situation as it is and in what directions we could go here in this project to start out with. Okay. Well, in terms of managing the integrity of structures, I think it would be fair to say that Freudenthal was really the front runner, and we are talking about, let's say, his work in the 40s, and we often reference one of his works from 1947. So the fundamental idea that we should establish a rationale based on the available information to base decisions on the management of integrity of structures is definitely not new. And a lot of developments have really taken place since Freudenthal. And it goes beyond my time limitation to talk about all these contributions, but you surely know and appreciate the enormous amount of work which has been performed in the period between then and now. It's then interesting also to see that the decision theory, the Bayesian decision theory in particular, has taken some big steps forward, was basically developed by Reifer and Schleifer sometimes in the 60s. And also, let's say, the fundamentals of utility theory came out von Neumann and Morgenstern, and a rationale was, let's say, crystallizing exactly in what way it would be correct to treat uncertain knowledge in the context of decision making. Now, we should also highlight that Benjamin and Cornell, actually at a very early stage, realized that he was something really important and really big, and in their, let's say, the standard textbook on statistics and probability for engineers, civil engineers, they highlight that, and they describe, let's say, the basic constituents of the Bayesian decision analysis in a very straightforward way, the prior, posterior, and pre-posterior decision analysis, and they even give a lot of good examples, but recognizing how long ago that actually is, it's pretty amazing how little has happened since then. So the application of, let's say, especially the pre-posterior decision analysis in engineering, in civil engineering, maybe in particular, but I'm not sure, has been long on the way. So the merits and potential benefits of utilizing pre-posterior decision analysis and value of information analysis has not really been realized and exploited. And we are, in many ways, we are standing right in front of a lot of interesting work in order to exploit this potential. And this action is, of course, meant also to push this in the particular context of structural health monitoring. So I would like to point let's say, a suggestion for different classes of engineering decision problems, civil engineering decision problems, where we could utilize pre-posterior decision analysis and value of information analysis. I would also like to give you the idea that management of structural safety, in principle, can seen as a purely information theoretical problem. So in an abstract sense, what we're actually dealing with is just managing information, and I hope to give you that idea. And then I will, as I already indicated, I will show in a very simple way how the value of information analysis can be used in the context of structural health monitoring. Yeah. So one way of classifying decision situations is what you see there. Structural health monitoring could be utilized in the context of prototype developments. It could also be used in the context of code making and calibration, both for design and for assessment of structures. It could be utilized in the broader context of optimizing strategies for warning. Warning, let's say, in the face of hazards or perils, which could either be due to, let's say, emerging natural hazards or due to emerging deterioration or other things where we have a time dependency, and then, of course, for the optimization of maintenance strategies where we normally are focusing. If we look at prototype developments, health monitoring of new structural concepts, like wind turbines, is a very good example, I think, where we are, you know, we are developing, we are trying to push the designs of new concepts all the time, but when we are, at some point in time, we are fixing things. And then these things, they go into mass production, and they are put up everywhere in the world. So we are talking about many, many, many structures which are put up in their environment. And in that process, prototyping is certainly a useful concept and it's also applied. But the structural health monitoring, in order to understand the performance of the structures and the types of loads and their responses, this is also being being utilized as it is now. But here, what we are doing could also contribute in a more rational and strategic manner to optimize design decisions. When we look at code making and code calibration for design and assessment of structures, again, an important issue concerns the, and this is, I guess it has over the years become more and more clear to me that model uncertainties with respect to the performance of structures in reality, as compared to the simplistic models and very often very highly idealized models that we are using, play a very big role. And structural health monitoring can help us in a strategic way at the level of strategic decision making on how to adapt and calibrate codes rationally. Then the issue of optimizing warning measures. That, as I mentioned, is a context where we have had some experience. It's really the type of problem which can be cooked down to, should I stay or should I go? Should we do something or should we leave it? And that type of sequential decision-making problem comes up in a number of cases in engineering. So if you have a typhoon emerging somewhere and you have a facility or structure you're worried about could be hit, but you're not sure that the typhoon will come your way, then this is a type of such situation. Let's say the monitoring is on the location and on the characteristics of the peril, in this case the typhoon. But there are many other similar contexts. Should we stay or should we run? And then, of course, for the optimization of maintenance strategies, the knowledge which we can collect during the lifetime of a structure certainly is very useful for supporting decisions. This has really been realized, I would say, already in the beginning of the 80s. There were a couple of groups, I believe, which can be attributed to significant work. One was a group around Palletoff Christensen and John. John was a small boy at that time, he was about this height, and I was a little bit smaller. But Pelle forced us to work in this domain. And at the same time at DNV, they were also working in this area, Henrik Madsen and his colleagues. And that was then the developments on risk-based inspection and maintenance planning, which was born. And that was really pre-posterior decision analysis in order to allocate resources optimally for management of integrity of structures. Now, structural health monitoring in many ways can add to that, because these optimal risk-based inspection plans can of course be adapted during the life cycle of the structures based on even more information which can be collected in between inspections. So the fundamental logic is that we sample information, knowledge, over the lifetime. Information costs, resources, money, ultimately. Depending on what technique we utilize, we get more or less precise information, but typically there's also the relationship between the precision and the cost. Using this information, we can adapt our strategies on how actually to intervene with the structure. And this is where we get the potential benefit out of the whole circus. If, of course, the information we collect is not correct or biased, the derived actions which we will identify as being optimal may actually not be optimal, and that again will not provide us optimal solutions. So the only basis we actually have for evaluating the benefit of collecting information during the life cycle of a structure is information we don't yet have. It's still out there. We can pick it up when it's there. And the benefit of this, thus, is the issue. How can we evaluate the benefit of this, right? And what has happened typically so far when the effect of structural health monitoring has been assessed and also quantified, mostly is that, let's say, time series of certain phenomena are anticipated. And then you see, okay, so if we use structural health monitoring, how could this be utilized? And which could, in that particular case, conditional on this particular evolution, what would the benefit of the structural health monitoring then be? But this is, of course, not correct. We don't know exactly what the future will bring, and therefore we need a different rationale. There's no doubt that structural health monitoring can significantly help in supporting decisions. Very little has been done so far on this, and there's no doubt that what we will do in this cost action will certainly contribute. When we talk about decision making in the context of assets management or structural integrity management, it's useful to look at the system. Is a let's say a system comprised of different constituents, and we are trying to make decisions on the basis of the knowledge we have. And we can, in principle, we can make two types of decisions. Either we can change the physics of the system or constituents of the system. So we can go in and make actual physical maintenance activities, so we can repair, we can do things. And in that way, we are actually shaping the physics. We do that, or we make our choices based on knowledge we have concerning the constituents. So it also makes sense to direct attention to the knowledge we can collect, the additional knowledge we can collect about the constituents, and the utilization of this additional knowledge to support a, let's say, a more optimal ranking of possible decision alternatives concerning physical changes. So it's, in principle, it's always a mix of these two principally different types of actions we can take, which is relevant. And in some cases, of course, knowledge is already sufficient, and additional information will not lead to anything except additional expenditures. In many cases, let's say carefully devised and strategically planned collection of additional information will actually provide a benefit. And this is where the value of information analysis comes in. If we look at the different, places where we can collect information when we're looking at the system and its constituents, then, of course, you can make many models. I've just taken the one from the Joint Committee on a system presentation. And as I said, other models apply. But here, at least, you get the idea that yes, we can monitor the performance of structural systems by looking at different things. So we can look at the exposure side. We can also look at the damages, which would be down here on the vulnerability, direct consequences, but we can also collect useful information on the functionality side, the indirect consequences. So information can be collected at different levels, and all this type of different information can provide very important knowledge for managing the integrity. And all this could be related or understood as structural health monitoring. And of course, we try to model the scenarios of events for such systems and also to calculate the corresponding risks. Now, what I said earlier concerning this perspective on management of information, that actually in many ways at an abstract level really describes what we are trying to do. When we are making decisions with respect to design or with respect to particular maintenance activities, design of course involves choices of materials in addition to the geometry and the statical systems, for instance, and also any other issue of dimensions for structural systems. And when we make those choices, what we really do in essence is that we are buying information. So when we choose one material for another material, we are buying information concerning the performance, and this information we immediately using probability theory and methods of structural reliability, we can immediately transform that to a probabilistic description. So already in this phase, what we are actually buying by designing, we are buying knowledge, we are buying information, and that information goes into the same pot as any other information which can be collected about the structural systems at a later point in time using, for instance, structural health monitoring. So altogether, I think also in this action, we should keep an open eye to possible, formulations and tools out of information theory. In principle, any design and also reassessment decision may be supported by prior decision analysis. Any decision on the assessment, inspections or monitoring may be supported by pre-posterior decision analysis. Now, when we are talking about monitoring, there's another issue I would like to underline, that it's actually, it concerns all sorts of collections of information. Normally, we understand by monitoring some continuous in time observation of some phenomena, but whether it's continuous or discrete or only one time or two times, it doesn't really matter. It's just a broader term for collecting information. In the prior decision analysis, it's all here very simple. So we have a space of possible decisions depending on the choice. We will have an outcome of nature, and depending on the outcome of nature and our decision, there will be an associated benefit or utility. We call it just benefit. We need to optimize decisions so that we get the highest expected value of the benefit, expected value that's dictated by von Neumann and Morgenstern, the axioms of utility theory. And that's very simple. So we buy information by choice of the prior density. This is essentially what we're doing. We select about possible different choices of prior probabilistic descriptions of this universe. So by buying a cross-section, by buying a geometry, we get information about the performance, right? And then we take this knowledge into account when we evaluate the benefit function. Okay, so Bayes' theorem on all this is very simple. If we have additional information, which we represent taking into account the uncertainty this information is associated with, then the knowledge we can build up the posterior on the basis of these informations are weighed with our prior on this particular phenomena of interest. And this is what we call updating, right? And then we can do posterior decision analysis in the same manner as we do the prior decision analysis, but now we remember here we have the double prime indicating that we are taking the expected value over the posterior description, probabilistic description. Otherwise, everything is the same, and as I indicated earlier, this is the extensive form decision analysis, which we then come into here, where we look at the possibilities to include new information in decision support even before we have collected this new information. And we do that by assuming that this new information that we are seeking will follow our prior models for the phenomena. And then we take into account this information, we average out over all possible outcomes according to our prior models, but every time in a way that we have realizations in this integration of the outcomes, then we optimize the decisions in the decision problem. And then we do the same again, and we average and maximize the choices on how to collect information. So this is what we are doing. We are taking decisions on how to collect information. We are observing what comes out of this these experiments, and on this basis we make decisions based on the decisions and everything which has happened before. We have a realization of the universe and the associated benefits, and this is the extensive form formulation of the pre-posterior decision analysis. And I just also want to highlight the normal form. They are, of course, equivalent. The major difference in the extensive form, normal form, concerns the necessity to include decision rules in the normal form decision analysis. And then, of course, the big difference operationally is that in the extensive form, we operate on the posterior probabilistic description. In the normal form, we operate solemnly in the prior probabilistic description. And that, of course, gives some, practical differences. And when we are looking at all the early works on risk-based inspection planning using the pre-posterior decision analysis, you will also realize that everything is in the normal form. And in the later years' developments on value of information analysis and structural health monitoring, immediately all the emphasis has been put on the extensive form formulations. I'm just saying that we should keep in mind that there are two equivalent formulations, and we can utilize those, of course, to the to support us in finding efficient schemes for doing the analysis. Yeah, okay. I want to point at a few recent works in the field, and I actually had taken all these papers with me. including one I cannot remember the name of, but that was this one. These are some of the more recent works. But in addition, there's also a very nice, let's say, a global overview of value of information analysis utilized across, let's say, all scientific fields. And this is a paper by Jeffrey Keisler and Collier and Xu and Sinatra and Linkoff. And it has the title of Value of Information Analysis, the State of Application. And that paper, of course, is really interesting because it gives a broader overview of the degree to which the different sciences and engineering fields are taking benefit of value of information analysis. These references, which I list here, they are selected. Of course, there's more out there. And in particular, I would like to draw your attention to a couple of PhD theses which have emerged here over the last 4 or 5 years, I guess. And one is Timo's. He's sitting down there. Timo, hand up. Another one is, of course, by Posse, a colleague, collaborator of Kyuregian. Another one, which does not have a title anywhere close to structural health monitoring, but which is really related to solving this sequential decision problem. Should we stay or should we run? Which is highly related to this is by Annette Anders. And then I believe Daniel, is your PhD student working in this area done now, or?
No, there are actually two or three.
Yeah.
One of them has it in the title, but they use the theory for different.
Yeah. And I'm sure that there will be other theses emerging or also already available. These contributions here, common for those contributions is that they almost all use the extensive form decision analysis formulation. They look at the in principle different variants of the same problem. You have a system, you have time involved, you have the possibility to collect information concerning the condition of your structural component or system, because some of them, they also go into different types of simple systems. And then you, based on what you collect and how you use this information in order to update your knowledge uncertainties, you can optimize your intervention. So this is really the issue of Posse and Kyuregian. They look at the identification of, let's say, efficient strategies for collecting information by looking really at the precision of the information you get from different techniques, and you can represent this very, very nicely in a given context. Sonta defines a member of society with the name Tom, and he's rational. This is a claim, and Tom is collecting information about the deterioration of a bridge in order to optimize his decision making, utilizing a couple of different types of monitoring devices to control whether the bridge is deteriorating beyond what is reasonable. Here in Konakli and myself here, Katarina is looking at more or less the same type of problem as Posse and Kyuregian, but also looking at simple parallel systems and series systems where we have the possibility to not only collect information about one component, but collect information about several components, and then, of course, depending on the dependencies between the components and their performances, this information can be affecting our probabilistic models of the other components as well. So Daniel, Lucas, who is with this paper here, looks into the formulation of the equations which we are utilizing in order to calculate the expected values, and there pinpoints that, of course, instead of just integrating our weighted utility as you would be inclined when you see the equations, you immediately also realize that this integration can be transformed into a series of let's say typical and well-known operations using structural reliability theory. So by identifying the relevant limit state functions which are involved and go into the calculation of the expected value of consequences, there seems it's quite obvious that some significant benefits also in terms of computational efforts can be achieved, and then also some directions on how to achieve efficient numerical treatment of these probability integrals using simulation techniques. In Rolskår, Joan, who's sitting over there, the main topic is to utilize forecasting models, which are, of course, associated with significant uncertainty as a basis for taking action on reducing expected value of losses in the context of falling ice from cable stays on large cable stay bridges. In the last paper here, which it's not actually published yet, so but it will be at the ICOSAR. It's really a kind of similar work in some ways as the approach suggested by Daniel, where the calculation of the expected values, the expected benefits, are undertaken in terms of structural reliability methods, but then where also a generic model is introduced on how to represent deterioration of systems. Of structural components, I'm sorry, not systems, is formulated, and it's shown in a very simple way how the different operations are to be undertaken in the decision analysis. Right. Concluding. In principle, value of information analysis is just another way of describing, some of the outputs from pre-posterior decision analysis. So there's nothing fundamentally, new in value of information analysis. It just comes out of pre-posterior decision analysis, and it was utilized already heavily, and it has been over the last 25 years. And there's a lot of ideas and approaches which could or could not be very useful also for this project here. The pre-posterior decision analysis has been applied to a number of different structural health monitoring problems already with success. I think what can be said is that in principle, it's straightforward to formulate the decision problems. In principle. when it's only in principle, it's because that those formulations are hardly to be found anywhere. So it's a sad reality that we are instrumenting structures every day, but we hardly care to formulate why we do it. Are we not able to quantify the benefit of it, but we are not even able, so we don't even care to formulate why are we actually doing it, and in what context are we really going to apply the information. In this paper, this overall study, this paper is relatively new, from 2013. Likewise, in the conclusions of Daniel's paper, it's highlighted that maybe at some point in time, someone should try to not only quantify the value of information, but also quantify the analysis of value of information in terms of benefit. So what is the actual benefit of going through the efforts of undertaking a value of information analysis? We need simply to provide methods so clear and tools so easy, and to disseminate whatever we find here in such a way that these approaches, this way of thinking, will be much better anchored and distributed. Major challenges, of course, the computational efforts. These event decision trees, they generally explode. They become really big very easily. And the one shown by Sebastian, it was called generic, but in a way, yes, it is generic, but all the different types of decision analysis context where we are looking at structural health monitoring, they are in principle very, very complex, because you have all the possibilities in the world to collect additional information and do this and do that, depending on what you find, and depending on a lot of other things which may happen in the meantime. We need to try to find a way of describing this in a categorized manner, which we can then find solutions for the categories. Now, and lots of idealizations. The only last thing I wanted to say is concerns the necessity that we look into other disciplines, like in the economics theory, where of course they do lots of decision analysis, for instance, in options, real options analysis. We found something when we were working for Annette and Kazuyoshi Nishishima. They found some very useful techniques from options analysis. Call stochastic meshing in order to analyze these very, very large event or decision event trees. And similar techniques may also be applicable for the type of applications we are looking at here, but there could also be other things hiding in some other scientific fields, so we need to be open for that. Okay, I didn't take 2 hours. I intended to take 10 minutes, so I guess I'm good. Thanks for your attention.